you know, really, Roy mentioned earlier, not just I'm of this church, but I'm of the church. And if groups are already doing things, find ways to, of course, within the parameters of safety and caution, participate with them. Don't try to recreate something, especially in small rural communities. It's going to give you more opportunities to work alongside of other believers and people who yet do not know Christ. And so jump in and be a part of that, again, with all the aspects of caution you're supposed to have. But let me just run a few ideas by you that we've really seen happen. I was driving up to Pyramid Lake. We recently moved to Nevada, except all of a sudden the road was closed down. There was checkpoints by the area of the Indian Nation that it has control, as it were, of that area because of COVID had hit this group of people very hard. Mm-hmm. So there are churches who are beginning to respond to various Indian tribal organizations, Navajo Nation Christian Response Team, and other nations that are taking place. And if you live in an area where that is a key issue, I would urge you to get involved, because what we're hearing from some of those nations is that churches are not jumping in on this, that they're getting other organizations, but they're having a difficulty getting involved with churches. So just get a hold of an ITO, which is an Indian tribal organization, to deal with this. Another big, huge issue is farmers to families. If you go to the USDA agricultural marketing section, so just type in farmers to families, food boxes, the government has put out gazillions of dollars. That's an actual technical phrase, I think. Gazillions of dollars to put farm product into the hands of the public. Most rural churches can't do this on their own because there's a lot of qualification issues. But you can partner with people who are doing this, and your church can be deeply involved with getting food right from the farms through the USDA to people in your community. I would urge you to look into that. And one of the ways you could partner is not only with other churches, but you could partner with school systems and other local agencies in order to have the facilities to accomplish that, because there are certainly requirements. That program is now set to run to the end of June, but it may be extended into July. Other churches are actually, as schools are starting to reopen, they're sending teams, especially in rural areas, where they're helping clean up the school, clean up, if there are buses, to clean up the buses, to help the staff do that, because a lot of smaller rural areas don't have that opportunity. Other teams are doing gift packs for seniors, seeds planted, you know, forget me not, and with a card enclosed, non-contact, placed on a porch, you know, just saying, we haven't forgotten you, we're praying for you, you are not alone. Other people are supporting local business. I know one church handed out gift cards to people in a drive-through food bank. They gave away various things. They gave gift cards to people who, to local restaurants. So those gift cards serve the purpose of also supporting local restaurants. You want to build up your reputation in your town with the local business owners? As a church, you start giving gift cards to their businesses to people, and you start building up really good rapport. Now, I'm going to stop there. I got about 30 other ideas. A little much, but because we all know about the drive-through food things. We do that. I'm going to tell one area that's very simple and costs nothing. Recently, I read a letter. A person is saying, you know what, they were just reacting. They were angry. I'm sort of tired of all the applause given to essential workers, hospitals, and doctors and nurses. I mean, I appreciate what they're doing, but they're all getting paid. They're all getting paid for what they do. I lost my job, and I don't have a job. I've lost everything. Or other people who say, wait a minute, I have to work. And no one's applauding me. When you go into a store, when you go into a restaurant, be incredibly gracious. Express appreciation for their being there. Express appreciation for what they're doing. And just do that as an act of grace. Let your light so shine before the world that people give glory to God for your testimony. And so, I'm going to take an offering now. So
thanks, Scott.
Someone got a background coming through.
Could you do me a favor too? Could you email me some of those links, the couple of the food?
Certainly.
Yeah, and we'll make that a part of the packet going out as well.
Okay.
Hey, Brian, what are you seeing in the more urban setting? Anything stand out to you? What you're seeing, what you've experienced in your church in terms of reaching beyond the walls?
Yeah, I think the biggest need that I've discovered in my community is with the children. In my community, the school is the babysitter pretty much. A lot of children are in single parent homes here, and the mother has to work, and pretty much sending the kids off to school every day is their way of having a babysitter for their kid. So now that the children are out of school, a lot of children are at home pretty much with nothing to do. And even where some parents are home with their children, they're not used to being there with the kids all day, and they're running out of things to do. So I think one of the ministry opportunities in Detroit, in a setting like in Detroit, is to be creative in finding some ways to help parents provide things for their children to do, whether virtually or otherwise. And so I've heard some parents express the desire for some curriculums that they can work with their kids on, something that they could do at home, where they can have school lessons with their children at home. There's homeschooling is not big around here. So there's a lot of parents who don't have curriculum stuff at home for their kids. Even devotional things to do, family worship with their children. It's not something that people are used to doing here. So I think a great ministry outreach here in a place like Detroit is to be able to come alongside the family and give them some resources that they can use in spending time with their children while their children are at home.
That's great. That's good. Yeah. So Doug, down in Florida there, what do you see?
So one of the interesting aspects of, I think the terminology you used was that the walls to the church have disappeared during this crisis. And the ability to reach out is a unique one. It's not that unique, but it's unique in that very rarely do we have the opportunity to do as we usually do, and that is gather at the church and go and do as, quote unquote, whatever the banner of your church would be. Serving the poor, helping in particular aspects of the community. But all of our congregations are scattered now, and they're scattered in their neighborhoods and in their workplaces if they're able to go to work. And so what we're trying to do is to celebrate those circumstances where a member of our congregation is buying groceries on a weekly basis for their next door neighbor. Or a member of our congregation is providing childcare for a family that has to work and they have no place for their kids. So you've got this, you've got a distributed kind of outward mission. And I think that's happening in all of our churches. The important thing is that we be able to tell that story, that this is the Lord at work through us in what shouldn't be unique ways, but are perhaps more magnified during this crisis. So just because the quote unquote church under the banner of a local congregation isn't going out and doing, it should be celebrated that our individual parishioners are doing a whole host of things that they may not even recognize, that they are ambassadors for Christ, that they are sharing the gospel in unique ways, that they are loving their neighbor. And so we're trying to do a better job of telling those stories and encouraging our body and letting everybody know that this is the church at work and this is the way the church should be working all the time. So take heed.
Yeah, that's a good principle to share those stories. It really is. Mm-hmm. Ed or Josh, you want to chime in at all on any of this at this point?
We have discovered the analog version of Facebook, which is our driveway and sidewalk chalk. We live in a neighborhood that seems to be populated by dogs walking their owners, and there just lots of folks that walk by, and if we're out doing some little chores, you get a chance to chat with people. have a true confession here. I'm not really part of a small church at this point. I guess we're part of a kind of a small medium church in Phoenix. And another true confession is we had to kind of look at our own hearts and say, now, wait a minute, we're kind of enjoying Sunday morning, getting up early and taking a 35-minute drive to church. One of the reasons we're feeling that way is because we're still connecting virtually with people that we have met and spent a lot of time with face to face. All right. Well, we're kind of in the middle of the bell curve as when people are returning to church. That's because I'm obviously I don't have to be there because I'm working with World Outreach, not pastoring a congregation. So it's I think most churches will get that bell curve that we've already heard mentioned. You know, there are some that are, you know, come on, why didn't we do this a month ago and open the doors back up? And others, they may not be back again. Mm-hmm. But there's a whole big bubble in the middle that, like my wife and I are going to say, okay, we'll let the church figure it out for a couple of weeks, and then we'll come. So anyway, there's been some interesting heart checks for us, but I don't know. Somebody may want to see if people want to use their driveway as an analog Facebook. Put some messages of hope out there for the neighborhood.
That's a really cool idea. Really cool. Good. Josh, you got anything?
You know, for us, this has just been a season of, you know, doing those things, kind of re-engaging missional practices. And one of the people I've enjoyed watching the most is actually my wife. Mm-hmm. I've seen others doing it. We're very blessed to live in a highly hiking friendly area. And, to Brian's point earlier, there's a lot of moms and kids out there that are just going crazy right now. And so I've watched her just invite one mom and kid after the next to go to a couple of hiking places she knows that are still open. And she takes our kids and she says, let's just go out and hike for a couple hours. And they connect, they're outside, they're not cloistered together. And it's a simple ministry, but I think it's almost created the opportunity to just to try it out, to just invite people she never would have asked to go for hikes, because she knows she's got the easy excuse. Are you going as crazy as we are? Oh, great. Well, hey, we were going to go hiking. Do you want to go with us? She hasn't had anybody turn her down yet.
So that's an interesting transformation, isn't it? Where that's an example of moving from, and I guess I'm expressing a prejudice here, point of view, but moving from a more programmatic building central kind of ministry into that one-on-one discipleship, evangelism, whatever you want to call it, relational kind of work that the church has always been known for and has actually been built on.
Exactly.
So kind of getting back to our roots. Good. So I'm going to ask the final question of the team here for just a quick round of response to this question. And so if you have questions, you can start using the chat feature. We'll open it up to you guys. And and I'll let you know if we're going to do a raise the hand thing, I'll let you know that. All right. So for the team, the last question here, do you have, and if you do, what do you think the sense is among the people that you're serving and working with, that the work that we're doing during this time is significant, and has their sense of ministry work increased or decreased? You know, that this is really they've grabbed hold of the importance of this time and how this can truly be an opportunity to explore new ways to minister. Has that increased or decreased, do you think? What's your sense of that in your congregations?
Are you asking how have members in the congregation sensed the importance of the ministry? How do they appreciate what we're doing for them, or
Their own sense? I'm sorry, the probably the question wasn't real clear. That the work you all are doing, whether it's you as pastors or the congregation in their individual ways, do you have a sense that they see this as really significant and different than what they've experienced before in that regard?
Yeah, I would think so. I know for myself, this situation has caused me to have to go check up on people, come by their houses. You know, we don't have rather regular gathering time, so I'll drop in individually on different people, whether it's to drop off some supplies if somebody's running low on things, or take the time out to make a phone call. It's caused me to have to be much more personal, and it has caused more effort. And I do think the people sense that. I think that I think they appreciate having a pastor. I've had that expressed to me quite a few times that it's a privilege to have someone who cares for them, someone who will pick up the phone and call, someone who will come and see about me. So I think that at least in my situation, people are seeing just how self-sacrificing pastoral work really is.
Good. Yeah. Josh, what do you think? Do you have a sense of that?
Yeah, there's a lot of gratitude, I think. And yet on the flip side, we've started talking a lot about this in the session that we think one of the great challenges that we have waiting for us is that folks have just grown very apathetic. Mm. In our church, and that there's going to be a lot of kind of pulling people out of themselves again, because that, and I almost think it's a coping mechanism. They've had to become apathetic just to get through this season. Mm-hmm. And so because of that, you know, it's, you know, you can wave a lot of wonderful things going on, and they don't have the eye that catches it quite as often as maybe they would. And so, I don't know how that's going to turn out, but I know that's a big piece that our session's talking about is how do we pull people out of themselves now?
Okay. Yeah.
I would say that this is a difficult thing to discern. I've had people tell me that they have appreciated my leadership during this, but I don't know that I've really had a conversation where someone has expressed that this is a significant time, and what we're doing during this time is important. So I would say I've received less feedback. I haven't gone searching for that, which maybe my fault, just to ask some simple questions about not just to get beyond how are you doing and to pray for them to see if there's any needs, but to how has this time shaped you differently? Mm-hmm. I can speak on behalf of my session because we meet once a week. I'm much more engaged in their lives. And there's, you know, there's been some significant moments as we make decisions together, as we pray consistently together. So I know with that group of parishioners, the leaders in the church, it's been very valuable and caused us to ask questions that we never thought we would ever ask. So, mm-hmm. So yes, from a leadership standpoint in the church, yes. From the general congregation, I don't know the answer to that.
Yeah. Okay. Good. All right. So getting a couple questions coming in. So we'll just throw it out here, guys, and see what we feel about this. Someone's asked, they're dealing with the, as you were, Doug, the surveys and trying to discern where people are in terms of let's open up now and let's wait a while. And the willingness in this congregation to go mask mandatory, which some are, is about 50%. So they're leaning toward not meeting again until they can meet as a unified congregation so that there's sense of unity on that. So the question in my mind would be, is that possible to reach a unified approach on all of that in any meaningful way, in any time-sensitive way, And if so, how would you go about that? I will just tell you that my wife and I, for the first time, went on a trip. We usually go on Sunday afternoon drives. And so we resumed that this last Sunday because we were looking for some plants. So we've waited long enough to put some stuff in the ground. And we went to one local nursery, large one. We had decided that if the group that was gathered there were mostly maskless, we weren't going to go. And that was the case. And this is a pretty big chain of nurseries in our area. So we decided to go to another one. And that one required masks. And you had, in fact, I think they were taking temperatures at the door. But the line was really huge. So we didn't go there, but we were appreciative of the fact that there they said, whether you're outside or not, you're going to wear a mask if you're going to come into our establishment. Same way at Lowe's. We went to Lowe's, national chain, big sign in front said, you got to wear a mask to come in here. And so that's where we did our shopping. But so it's kind of interesting to me, and this is a thing that's coming up more often, is congregations, knowing they're going to gather in a small place for a period of time, are really resistant in many ways of wearing masks, mm-hmm. where businesses, where they shop, require it. So, thoughts?
Yeah, this will be our church in the Phoenix area here. In their survey showed that really 60% of the people thought everyone should wear masks, and 40% didn't. The decision of the session was that everyone will wear a mask. If you don't bring one with you, we'll give you one at the door. And, you know, we will seat you in pre-designated areas. So, a sanctuary that'll seat 300 or so are going to be 75 people in it, and everybody wearing a mask. But I was surprised of the, so there are 4 out of 10 people said, nope, we don't think, maybe those 40% are not going to show up. I don't know how that will work, but I was surprised by the percentage,
mm-hmm.
but 4 out of 10 thought, no, we're not, not going to do the mask thing.
Yeah.
I would say 4 out of 10 is pretty representative of my congregation. And I haven't been there that long, but I know I've talked to enough people during this, during the time of COVID to know where the ones who are more adamant about not wearing a mask, who they are and what. And so I want to be careful. I really do. And this is much more of a discerning thing than people might think. For those who are online tonight, who are in Florida, you know that Florida never closed churches technically, but the most churches did close just because gathering inside with a large number of people is foolish. And I think most latched onto that, but a lot didn't. And so there's a sense in Florida overall, Roy, if I were to take your same scenario, wherever I went, at least half the people would not be wearing masks.
Mm.
And there are some places that do require masks, but I think there is still just a sense of the population who say, you can't tell me to do that. You're not going to make me do that. So we're trying to discern as leadership. This Sunday, we have crafted our directions to say, you know the drill. This is just like going to the grocery store. And we didn't say masks required. We just said we strongly encourage masks. And so we're going to see how that looks. If we have 4 out of 10, I don't know, but I think when you state it as you are required to wear a mask if you're going to come into this worship center or this sanctuary, you're going to end up with some interesting responses.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
It might be interesting to perhaps speak to Romans 14 in believers preferring one another, and maybe as a something to try to talk to the congregation. We all know that the masks have become a political issue.
Yeah.
And so that's also a layer to be dealt with, and with grace. And I think, you know, trying to show people there's a distinction between a governmental mandate and a congregational care and preference for one another is at least going to have to be addressed in churches.
Yeah, I think this is important. This goes back to our teachable moments. This is one of those where a biblical principle and priority definitely definitely supersedes, and that's no political, I'm not making a statement about that, supersedes anything the government might say at any time. And that's what we're really governed by. King Jesus is our king, right? And so the scriptures are what give us the parameters that we live by. So I'm thinking that in regard to the question, it's going to be difficult, if not impossible, to come to any unified position. And this is one of the things, and I'll just express a preference here. One of the reasons I really like the Presbyterian system of government is that it has its really good side here, is that elders lead and make the call. And we aren't congregational based in terms of our decision making. We are leading. And we use the wisdom of the Spirit and the discernment that God gives us in the scriptures to guide and to lead. That doesn't mean we don't take input and do the surveys, because we've done those. But I think that it is a difficult place, but that's what we signed up for. It's what we were called to in the church as TEs and REs, is this is our time, and we have to exercise that leadership. And we have a system that supports that. So, just hope you lean into that. All right. This is going to be the last question that's being asked. Let's see. Probably put these together. So the question is, there's a difference between thriving and surviving. Does anyone see their church thriving during this time, rather than just kind of making it through? And so I'll just throw that out there. Any sense of whether you're thriving or just getting by?
We're not thriving at all. We are getting by. However, I think we're also looking at this with the intentionality that the Lord makes beautiful many, many difficult things. And as we talked about this last week, is it would be a shame not to come out of this season having really examined ourselves and asked, why are we here? What are we doing here? And how is this going to change who we're becoming? I think we have to see this as a sanctifying moment, and that's on the leadership to help, you know, navigate that picture. But I'll speak for my church right now. We're not thriving, but I think we're trying to narrate a story that's happening right now so that we can build hope, because I think that's what A, takes us through this, but B, helps us to really come out of this with the gospel at the forefront of our vision. So.
Good.
Yeah, I think that's good what Josh just said. Same here, especially us. We're a 3-year-old church plant, so we're definitely not thriving. But at the same time, we're hanging in. But at the same time, I think there is a bonding and a deepening that's taking place, mm-hmm. because we're experiencing going through something together. This is kind of like a family affliction that we're all coming together to fight this thing together. I think we're learning to appreciate what we're missing now. I think people are going to come through this with a deeper appreciation for gathered worship and for fellowship. I believe that when we're able to come back together, again, I know there's going to be a small minority of people who may lay back a little bit because they're still afraid. But for those who are eager to come back, I think there's going to be a deeper appreciation for the fellowship and for the gathered worship. And even on the Zoom calls, I think that there is a deeper intimacy that's taking place, because when we do our Zoom prayer time, before that, we all kind of give an update. We give everybody a chance to just kind of talk about, well, what have you been dealing with this week? How are you doing spiritually? How is this affecting you? And people are speaking mm-hmm. from their hearts about mm-hmm. some of their fears and about some of the things that they're dealing with. And it's causing us to get to know each other a little better, because there's some transparency going on there. So we're not thriving, but underneath the surface, there's a bonding and a deeper intimacy that is beginning to take place, which I think is going to pay dividends in the future.
That's great. Good.
So I think that both Josh and Brian, in what they just explained, though they began by saying we're not necessarily thriving, depending on their metrics, if the metrics were, are we growing in prayer? Are we more reliant upon the gospel? Are we developing leadership? Then there is certainly a sense of vitality in that. Our congregation falls in the same boat as Josh's and Brian's. There is a sense by some of our older metrics. No, we're not driving, but I mean, I think what we've all learned through this is, not only is there going to be a new normal, but I think there should be a new set of metrics too. How are we measuring our success? How are we measuring our vitality? Because coming out of this, we're going to be vital in different ways. And so I think that's the encouraging side of that. Are we vital from some of our old measurements? No. But are we vital in new ways? Yeah, we are. Hmm.
That's a great distinction. And I think something that we can be encouraged by and carry forward.
I was listening to Bishop Tim Keller this morning. Oh, I don't know. No, he's not the bishop. But anyway. Tim, he was talking about Psalm 1 and taking off on, people started talking about this, COVID-19, kind of likening it, using some winter analogies. So is this a blizzard for us? We hunker down for a little while and we get back out just like, streets are cleared and we're back to normal. Or maybe it's a winter season where it's still it's longer, but at the end of it, you get back to normal. Maybe you're a little heavier, whatever. Anyway, you eventually get back to it. But maybe it's an ice age, or at the end of it, there are significant changes, and the world is not the same anymore. And he's saying that the secret in that, it doesn't matter whether it's a blizzard, whether it's the wintertime, or whether it's an ice age. It doesn't matter if we are daily sinking our roots into the Word of God. Even in the wintertime, the evergreens are green. So, meditate on the Word of God, sink it deeply into our souls, and we will be evergreen even in an ice age.
Yeah.
So that's kind of metric. It's hard to put a ruler to that, hard to measure it with a number. But I thought, that's very helpful. And I'm, some will come through thinking, wow, this was, the Lord really did some work in me. Others will say, wow, that was, I wasted a lot of time, didn't I? Mm-hmm. Netflix spent more time with Netflix than with the Lord. So, mm-hmm. I'm sure people, and that'll be a pastoral thing. Even for our own, even for those of us gathered here, know, how has the Lord worked? Working with smaller churches overseas, and I haven't heard a lot. So I'm going to see if I can collect some stories and be able to share with, you know, how is this affecting people, outside the U.S. Because a lot of those folks, a lot of folks we work with don't have the, where we're hunkering down is pretty luxurious compared to a lot of our brothers and sisters around the world.
I read that article that Tim Keller referred to. Actually, I think it's authored by Andy Crouch. The interesting part about that is when you consider those three spans of time, blizzard, winter, or ice age, we're nearing that first demarcation point because the blizzard's about over. The big storm is about over, and we're about to now enter into the longer stretch of winter. So we almost are at that place where we can look back and say, okay, how did we do? Did we make it through the blizzard? Because there's some that won't. There's some churches and leaders that won't make it through the blizzard, but can still, there's a lot ahead of us. And will it be a winter or an ice age is the big question.
And someone reminded us that, as we move into that time, we have a lot of resources, not just physically in our physical realm, but to remind us that we do actually have the Holy Spirit at work in us and in our churches, and we lean into Him as well. And we shouldn't, as I said in the comment, not be afraid of the new normal. So that's good. I will give you one example. I was reminded by someone on here that in our church, we're going to try something new in terms of the opening up. We are toying with the idea, and probably will do this, that before we open up to everybody else, we're recording our services on Saturdays and showing and posting them on Sundays. The first Sunday of in-presence meeting is just going to be the leadership. It's just going to be the elders, and we're going to be sitting there in that place. Two things. It serves the purpose of testing out a lot of the stuff and our processes and how we're going to keep people safe and all the routines that we're going to go through in that. But I think it does show deference, and it shows a willingness on our part to say that we're going to respect this. We're going to respect each other, the social distancing, all the things we're going to ask everybody else to do, we're going to do, and set the tone for that. So just an idea to throw out there for that. All right, we are coming to an end. As if no one else has another question, if you want to raise your hand, I will catch that on my little handy chart over here. If not, then we will begin to close this out. I do want to just recap a couple of things here that in terms of our takeaways for this time, is that we are doing significant work. And as Doug just reminded us, we need to change our metrics a little bit in terms of how we evaluate our ministries and our lives as a congregation going through this time. It's not going to be the same metric as we did before. And so there are things that we're doing that are truly significant. I truly want you to celebrate that, and I celebrate what you are doing in your leadership in your congregations to stay connected, to do ministry outside of the walls. I think there's stuff happening, and it's good stuff that can be carried forward if we're willing. And to break down that silo mentality that we all struggle with in our churches, especially in America, and reaching out beyond our walls. Certainly the idea that sharing the ministry and delegating it out and engaging all the leaders in the process is really, really important for us to keep in mind. And just the value that people place on, and then we should celebrate this and lean into as well. It is important for us to be together physically. It's going to be scary for some, and we have to honor that. We have to not judge those people who aren't willing to step into the new normal just yet. We have to pray for them, encourage them, and just stand with them in that. But the importance of being physically present remains. So it's good to be with you guys and gals, and just enjoyed this time. Thank you for being a part of this. I want to invite you to next week, June the 4th. We're going to talk about a really touchy subject, and that's facing the financial impact of all of this and how we're going to deal with that issue. The notes and recording will be available to you. I do want to encourage you, if you are a pastor in the EPC, if you're not a part of the pastor's Facebook page, EPC pastor's Facebook page, or the pastors of small EPC churches, there's two groups. Please look those up and join them. There's some good discussion and good questions that go on there. Thank you for joining us. Again, we hope this has been helpful to you and will be an encouragement to you, to all of us as we move forward. And having said that, have a wonderful weekend. Enjoy your time. All right. Good night, all.
God bless.